Assalaamu Alaikum and welcome to part 3 of the Hadith of the Halal and the Haram. And I carry on from where I left. And I say this. If the job of the messenger was to explain and clarify to mankind the meanings of the Qur'an, then the Prophet Muhammad should have remained alive until the end of time. Because all Muslims in all time and places must listen to that explanation. They will need that explanation. But that didn't take place. That didn't happen at all. So what did the men of religion do? They say and they claim that the Messenger of Allah had explained the Quran. And let's say for a split of a second that he did. And he didn't. But let's say just for argument's sake, right? So what did they do? They left for the explanation and left the Quran. They went for the explanations and abandoned the original text. And this is incredibly crazy. Therefore, my dear sisters and my brothers, the job of Muhammad as a messenger is to spread, divulge, broadcast, read out, voice out, publish what Allah sent to mankind. And in order for this messenger to carry on the duty that Allah has given him, that is to broadcast, to let people know what Allah has revealed, he could do that when he leads a salat. That's why the Quran, the messenger is reported to, his salat was long. He used to read a lot of Quran. Why? To give the ability to the Muslims to hear what Allah has revealed for them. He didn't read to them قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, two lines and finish. He didn't read إِنَّ أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرْ, with line and finish. No. Even in the historical books of hadith, they say the messenger of Allah's salat, and this is one of the believers that was at his time, said, from the time the salat began, one of us could go out to the wilderness for their nature for pee and poop. And imagine you walk, like probably walk for 5 minutes. Let's say you walk for 5 minutes, then you carry your job, your need, and then you clean yourself. And you come back, by the time you get there, it's 15 minutes. And then they would go and perform wudu. And then they say, and we used to go to the masjid to perform salat, and the messenger was still in his salat. Yes, why? Because he read the Quran, loud voice for people to understand and learn. That's one part. Other one is when he meets people in the streets, in the markets, in the places of meetings, in the bars, clubs, whatever, he goes there. He would read the Quran to them. He reads it out to people without any explanation. And this is crucial. Because if he reads the Quran and explains it, people do not know what Allah has revealed and what hasn't. That's why the only thing that the messenger did was read the Quran to the people without any external interferences. He reads it as he received it. When he's preaching Islam to people, when he's talking to the non-believers, when he's asked questions, that's why they go to him. Allah says, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ, and they ask you about whatever. Allah straight away says, قُلْ, tell them, and Allah answers right there and then. It was not the job of Muhammad to answer question. So, and when he was challenged by non-believers, and people that opposed him and all those people, guess who answered? It was Allah who answered direct. And that's why Allah says, وَقَالُوا, and they said, قُلْ, tell them. So there was that, so Rasulullah was the link between Allah and humanity, and so was any other messenger before him. You see, one thing that the messenger didn't do, and he never did, he never ever sat in a mosque, on his mosque, or anywhere for that matter, and formed a circle and started teaching people the meaning of this or that ayah. Never, ever. Never, ever. He never sat in a high chair with people facing him and then started explaining the Quran. He never built a university to teach people. Anyone who makes this claim is a pure liar. Why am I telling you all this? I could have told this the meaning in 20 minutes and end. Why am I going now part 2, 50-50 and this one? And it took me over 5 weeks to research and write this paper. And only Allah knows in the last 5 days I went through the same note, adding and trimming and all these things. Why? Why am I telling you this? Well, the reason I'm telling you this is really simple. You have been lied to. Too, and it is your right at least to know the other side of the story, especially that the Salafi cult is doing its utmost at keeping this lie of the hadith that says the halal is clear and the haram is clear. The in-betweens, they do the best of what they can at keeping it alive, and they deliver it to you as if it were the Quran. You cannot question this thing. And the moment you say something, they throw in the righteous predecessors. And they tell you, that's it. There you go. They accepted it. Why don't you accept it? So the reason I'm telling you this is because on Judgment Day, when you stand for accountability, believe me, you will have difficult times proving to Allah that things are three: halal clear, haram clear, and in between them unclear. You'll have difficulty. And towards the end of this talk, I will bring in the Quran to weigh in, because there is only, as far as Allah is concerned, there is the halal and the haram. There is nothing of what is the in between. You see, if the Quran could speak, if the Quran had the ability to say things, as we do, as I speak like this, if the Quran was free to talk to us, if the pages of the Quran could hold a conversation with us, they will get thirsty for the number of time they will repeat, the religion belongs to Allah and only on Him says what goes inside it, nor has or had the right to speak on behalf of Him. The religion of Allah and to Allah is Islam, nobody else. Believe me, it will keep saying this and this and this and this until it sinks in our heads. What the man of religion say about this hadith narrative? See, before we proceed, what do they say? Well, we need to understand, because to uncover the fakeness of this hadith and the dangers it posed in the past and poses now, we need to know what the man of religion think about it. And we're going to start first by hearing the most or the prominent people of the Salafi cult. Why do I say Salafi? As opposed to whom? As opposed to the Shia. That's it. And the moment you say Salafi, it has everybody else inside it. You see, what our sheikhs have done in the 3rd century, they have committed the biggest mistake of their lives. And on Judgment Day, I pray to Allah, they didn't do it deliberately, but anyone who did this with deliberance and really meant it and things like that, they will have a hard time. And anyhow, even without being deliberate about doing these things, they will be held accountable, because the outcome of what they did has destroyed us and will carry on destroying us until we remove this stupid fake hadith of the halal and the haram and the in-between. Here is what they did. They said that al-Islam, the entire religion of Allah, can be summarized by three hadiths. Not the Quran, not the 6,000 ayat in the Quran, but it can be summarized by three hadiths. Three. And they will say to you that these three hadith narratives, and what I mean three is as in one, two, three, yeah? They say that the entire of Islam, you take anything in Islam and you look at the purpose of the existence of that rule by Allah or anything like that, it will end up, ultimately will end up under one of the three titles, big titles. The leader of this lie is Ahmed ibn Hanbal. Ahmed ibn Hanbal is the teacher of Al-Bukhari and Muslim and Abu Dawood and Ibn Majah and An-Nasa'i and all these people. And he also have collected a book of hadith. His book of hadith contains over 30,000 hadiths, unlike Bukhari and Muslim. And most of what is in Al-Bukhari Muslim exists in Musnad Ahmed. The Musnad Eminin is the hadith that can be traced to Rasulullah. It has sanad. This man was born in the year 164, so towards the end of the 2nd century. And of course, he made it to the 3rd century when the hadith was, Islam was documented. In the Christian era calendar, 780. And he died in the year 241, so towards the middle of the 3rd century, 855 Christian era. This man, Ahmed ibn Hanbal, was and still is over-praised, over-exaggerated, over-raised above anyone else, especially when they linked him to an incident that every sheikh knows, and that incident is the creation of the Quran. And people do not know what it really means, and they say, oh, Ahmed ibn Hanbal, he resisted the tribulation and the problem of the creation of the Quran. It was Ahmed ibn Hanbal who said, anything that is in Al-Quran was decreed before the happening, and the Quran was existed before anything else. In other words, when the messenger of Allah, for example, made a mistake and Allah was angry at him in Al-Quran. All right. Ahmed ibn Hanbal said that Allah had known this would happen before and decided it in the Quran before it's happening. And then Allah made the incident of Muhammad making the error. Then Allah also made the incident of him being angry at Muhammad. And then he revealed what already was in the Quran. The other party said, no. If you say that, then the whole thing becomes a joke. Why do we have a judgment today? Why? And then, and when Ahmed ibn Hanbal entered in a confrontation against the other ones, he said, Ahmed ibn Hanbal, as I said to you already, that he said everything was created before the happening of the Quran. The other one said that. And that's why they say the creation of the Quran is not the Quran per se. It's what goes, what the rules and laws of Allah in the Quran. Long story short, and I will speak about this there. What they say is, every single scholar in the 3rd century had succumbed and submitted to the idea that the Quran was created, i.e. the incidents of the Quran were created as they happened, which is the truth. Except Ahmed ibn Hanbal said, no, the Quran was not created, i.e. everything was predetermined and whatever was in the Quran was meant to happen. The other one say, no, things happen, then Allah responds. Ahmed ibn Hanbal says, no, the Quran was there, then Allah created the things to respond to the Quran. They tell you every single scholar out there succumbed except Ahmed ibn Hanbal, and that's why they call him the leading authority of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, Imamu Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah. And anything that Ahmed ibn Hanbal says becomes like Islam. Oh, actually, it becomes Islam. But anyhow, so this Ahmed ibn Hanbal, and after him the Salafi cult, state that the foundation of Islam is based on 3 hadiths. Again, not the Quran, just the hadith. And this is why I say we have a parallel religion built on something far off the Quran. And I will explain a little bit more, and I've already said so many things, and you just go back to my YouTube channel, please. There are lots of talks about this. The first hadith is the following, by Umar ibn al-Khattab, about the intentions. They say the outcome of actions depends on intentions. So that's 1/3 of Islam there. The second hadith is that of Aisha about innovations. Whoever innovates something in our Islam, in our matter, that is not part of it, it will be rejected. من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد. That's it. And that's why you hear the Salafis, oh, this is bid'ah, this is innovation, because they keep going to the second pillar of what summarizes Islam. And the third one is the hadith of An-Nu'man ibn Bashir, the halal is clear and the haram is clear, and between them are unclear matters. So as far as our Salafis and our Islam that we have today, Islam can be summarized by 3 hadiths. 1, the intentions of Umar, that the outcome of actions depends on the intention. Even Bukhari, Muslim, most of the hadith scholars start their books with this hadith. And it became like a fashion for anyone who writes a book to start with that. Kind of like to clear and clean their intentions. Don't lie out there. The second one is the innovation. If you do something that was not at the time of the messenger, it's an innovation and you'll be rejected and it's haram and you go to hellfire and things like that. The third one, the halal is clear, the haram is clear, and between them are matters of confusion and things like that. You see where the danger is? Not the Quran. Not وَبِالْحَقِّ أَنْزَلْنَا, and with the truth we have sent it down, And by the truth, it was sent down. The Quran contains the truth of what Allah wants in His Islam. And Allah didn't send the Quran as a joke. He sent it in a truth. It needed to be sent. But our sheikhs, they say, no, the Islam can be summarized by 3 hadith. Just like that. Notice how the Quran has absolutely no presence in Mr. Ahmed's Ibn Hanbal Foundation or the Islam division by the Salafis and things like that. Nothing. Since that accursed 3rd century, both Islam and Muslims are living in the total darkness, away from the light that Allah has placed in the Quran and the Quran alone. This is why anyone who brings the Quran is fought to death. They even use the term, you are a Qurani, to insult you. But for them to be a Sunni, it's a privilege. When you are a Qurani, a follower of the Quran, you are doomed. You are the devil in disguise. When you follow the Sunnah, you are the best of who could be there. It's crazy. And this is why I will keep on fighting for the Quran and the Quran times and times and times, even if that means my death. I'll go now back to the words that were used in the hadith narrative of the three, the halal and the haram, the 3rd of Islam, subhanAllah. In Al-Bukhari, it says, وَبَيْنَهُمَا مُشَبَّهَاتٌ, resemblance. And between them are matters that have resemblance, unknown to people. So what the hadith says in Al-Bukhari is that the halal is clear, the haram is clear, yet in between them, there are issues that resemble the halal and the haram. So if that is the case, we cannot state that the halal is clear, the haram is clear. Since between them, there are things, we don't know if they are halal and haram and they resemble each other. That's in Bukhari. But in Muslim, it says, mushtabihat, confusing. So the question becomes here is this hadith about things that resemble each other? And in which case, where in Allah's book, Allah has created something that is halal and haram, and it resembles each other. At the same time, they resemble each other. It's like two siblings. It doesn't exist. How can something be at the same time halal and haram? So much so to cause the majority of people not know. Which of these two versions did Allah, if He did, of course He didn't, reveal to His messenger? Since the hadith is the wordings and the understandings are from the messenger. I would have loved to have a conversation with Ahmed Didat, because he used to carry the Bible. Oh, in this it says this, and on that it says that. Which one has Allah revealed? All this to knock down the Bible. I can produce for him thousands upon thousands of hadith contradicting each other. And I would love to have seen him answer that question. He cannot. Not him, nor Zaki Nark, I don't know what his name is, or any other person, because we have a lot of confusion. The only time Ahmed did that thrived, because the people he was conversing with didn't have the edge that he had. If they had known Quran as today and the hadith as today, they would win the argument against him. That's now, let's take a break from the hadith and go to the narrator himself, An-Nu'man ibn Bashir. Who is he? And why is it only him that has narrated this hadith? Why not Abu Bakr? Why not Umar? Why not Uthman? Why not Ali? Why not this? Why not that? Why not the wives of the messenger? Why not the great shot companions, as they called them at that time? Why was it only An-Nu'man ibn Bashir? And the problem, once you know who An-Nu'man ibn Bashir, you're going to scratch your hair. Here's a little bit about this narrator, An-Nu'man ibn Bashir. They said he was the firstborn to the people of Al-Madina after the arrival of the Prophet. Okay. I don't know how they ended up with that, but that's what they say, the firstborn. And as if that had any weight in Islam. But anyhow. Historians and biographers said that as soon as An-Nu'man ibn Bashir, the firstborn of the people of Medina, was born, his mom took him to the Prophet. And then the Prophet took a date. He chewed it and then put it in An-Nu'man's mouth and made dua for him. What they actually are saying is this. This kid, Nu'man ibn Bashir's body, had the saliva of the Prophet inside him. And because of that, he was very pious. He was the ultimate honest and truthful person. And as such, he must be believed in anything he says. That's all they said. That's why they put this fancy schmancy description before him and telling us all these things. That's all they we have. Oh, the saliva of the messenger went inside him. Now when he grows, he has something of the messenger in him. But the most interesting thing about this narrator, An-Nu'man ibn Bashir, is that he was born 8 years and 4 months, as they say, before the death of the messenger. Meaning, when the messenger of Allah died, An-Nu'man ibn Bashir, the narrator of this hadith, was 8 years and 4 months. You heard it correct. An-Nu'man was 8 years and 4 months old. It was not Abu Bakr, who we are told was always at the side of the messenger. Every day they met to plan how to do the da'wah and everything. No, it was not that. It was not Ali or Fatima or Aisha or Hafsa, these people that he saw on a daily basis. It was not Umar ibn al-Khattab, who we are told in hadiths that he used to spend one day him with the messenger, and when he went about his business the next day, there was another friend of his who was with the messenger. And Umar said, because he didn't want to miss anything from the messenger. Nothing. How come it's not Abdullah ibn Mas'ud? Not Abdullah ibn Abbas? Not even Abu Huraira? Nobody. It was a kid of 8 years and 4 months old who heard the messenger of Allah speak such a nonsense hadith, which ended up a third of al-Islam. It's mind-boggling. What's even more disturbing is the fact that this kid kept the narrative to himself and never said it to anybody until he reached the age of puberty. Why did he do that? Who gave him the permission to withhold such an extremely important foundation of Islam, as the Salafis say? Of course, to me is a nonsense. One of the thousands of other people who lived at the same time of the messenger. Why is it only him who heard the Prophet say that? What was the messenger of Allah doing that he, look at this, when the messenger said it, An-Nu'man ibn Bashir, a kid of 8 years, heard it from the messenger. Was the messenger teaching him one-to-one? Was the messenger talking to himself in the mirror? What was, how did this kid end up hearing this? How? If someone says, oh, the messenger was talking to someone else, then why didn't the other one report what the messenger told them? Why he said, I heard the messenger. If he heard the messenger, certainly the messenger was saying it to somebody else or some other people. Why the other people didn't report this hadith? Why is it only an 8 years old kid? Why? It's mind-boggling. Once you start asking questions, you can't. An-Nu'man ibn Bashir died assassinated when he was 64 years of age. No respect for human life. Assassinated. The hadith narrative that states the halal is well known and defined, and it also states that the haram is well known and defined, then it goes and blows these two definitions of halal being clear and haram being clear with those things that are the unknowns, the not certain things, the I'm not sure things, I'm confused about these things. How can that be? The other danger, my dear sisters and my brothers, if the hadith narrative, if there was a hadith narrative somewhere where the messenger of Allah said, oh, by the way, halal is not all equal. There is a halal which is 100%, then there is another halal which is 90, 80, 70, 65, and things like that. And so is the haram. There is one haram that is 1% haram, and another haram 5, 10, until you get to the 100% haram. At which case, the halal is not clear, because there is one that is 100% and the other one is 80%. And the haram cannot be clear, because there is 10% haram and there is 100% haram. Yes, in which case here, if something is 80% halal and 20% haram, then we understand that there is an element of confusion. But when the hadith states that the halal is clear and well-defined, and the haram is clear and well-defined, and as far as Allah is concerned, there is not something that is very halal or very haram, or little bit halal or little bit haram. What is halal is 100% halal. What is haram is 100% haram. There is no percentages option here. And these things that are unclear, that are ambiguous, that are imprecise, that are obscure, that are blurry, that are confusing, are they part of the halal or are they part of the haram? Because when the message of the hadith narrative divided the halal into this block and the haram into that block, there is no chance for a third block. So these unclear and ambiguous and obscure things that suddenly found themselves between two well-defined blocks, how did they end up there? If they are haram, why aren't they part of the haram? And if they are not haram, why aren't they part of the halal? The dangers of the impact of this hadith narrative, which divides things into three, is not just about making something halal and something haram, and then there are those things that are unclear, ambiguous, and things like that. It goes beyond this. It has created centuries upon centuries of discord, disagreement, even hatred, fights, and killings. For example, a Shafi'i, the founder of the Shafi'i school of thought, was killed by a Maliki person. Why? Because a Shafi'i said something that disagrees with the Maliki school of thought in Egypt. And the Shafi'i got assassinated and murdered just because he said something against the other school of thought. Isn't that something? I can sit here and give you At-Tabari. At-Tabari is the head of the tafsir. He is the most prominent figure in the tafsir, and his book is existent for, was killed because he said that the Hanbali school of thought of Ahmad ibn Hanbal cannot be considered as a school of thought. Because Ahmad ibn Hanbal is just a collector of hadith. Well, the followers of the Hanbali school of thought, which are today the Wahhabi or the Saudis or the Salafis today, they killed At-Tabari and they stoned him to death. So much so that At-Tabari was buried at night because the authorities at that time didn't want to know where he was buried, because people would go and dig his grave and mutilate and do evil things to him. So if the in-betweens are known by a small minority, why do we have a school of thoughts and scholars that disagree with others for centuries? Disagreements after disagreements, discords after discords. So many schools of thoughts have been created, so many alliances against this school of thoughts, against these scholars, so much bloodshed throughout the past centuries until today. You find the Saudi Arabia today, the High Council of the Islamic Affairs, disagree 100% with Al-Azhar University of Egypt, with what happens in Libya, in Tunisia, in Morocco, in Algeria, in Mauritania. They disagree to death. If the halal is clear and the haram is clear and between them are unknown matters that the minority knows, why is the minority fighting itself to death? Why hasn't Allah done us a favor and cleared these things? Told us what is wrong, what is not. Why has the messenger betrayed us by not telling us what those confusing, ambiguous things were, so that we don't end up fighting? Why? But the real reason behind this shaitanic hadith narrative was to give the men of religion, scholars, sheikhs, the collectors of hadith narrative, the explainers of the Quran, the historians, anyone who speaks with the name in the name of Allah, this hadith narrative gave them unlimited powers to control people's lives, from the biggest part to the smallest part, to tell people what to do, what to wear, what to eat, how to get married, how to go to the toilet, how to invite people and be invited at home, how to behave with the wind, with the rain, what activities should be done in which day, how to fart, how to cut nails, and the list goes on and on and on and on. They gave themselves a ticket to control every aspect of Muslims' lives. This is the real reason of this poisoning, human-invented hadith narrative that Allah and the messengers are innocent from. The halal is clear and the haram is clear, and between them are matters unclear. This is a lie and it needs to be brought to its demise. And for that, we need to run an autopsy to reveal the misguidance this hadith narrative contains. Let's look at the different part of this hadith. It states that it divides things really in few parts. Part number one. It says that things are divided into three well-defined categories. The halal is clear, that's one category. The haram is clear, that's one category. And between them are matters that are unclear, and either they like it or they don't like it. That's still a third category. The halal, the clear, the haram, the clear, and the third category are the unclears. Second part, they divide people into two distinct categories. Those who know, and they are the high, and they are needed, and those who do not know, which is the majority of Muslims, and as we already said, that the scholars are needed, but the scholars do not need people. That sets the status. The third part is divide people into those who are pious and take precautions not to enter the third category of the unclear, and those who are not pious according to the other ones. Why? Because they enter the category, the third category. The fourth part is to link the well-being or the doom of the human being based on where they stand vis-a-vis of the unclear and confusion. And that's why they say, whoever is cautious of those unclear matters has exonerated his religion and honor. And whoever indulges in them has indulged in haram. And then they go, it's like a shepherd who herds his sheep too close to the sanctuary and things like that. The fifth part is they say every king has forbidden boundaries. And the forbidden boundaries of Allah are what he has made haram. Now, if this is the case, then what are Allah's open boundaries? Because if the closed boundaries is his haram, he must have other open boundaries to make his halal. Or the halal has no boundaries and the haram has boundaries. It's clear once you start thinking about this, it's crazy. The sixth path is, they say, there lies within the human body a piece of flesh. If that piece of flesh is sound, the entire body is sound. And if that piece of flesh is corrupt, then the whole body is corrupt. And that piece of flesh is the human heart. And we all know there is no such thing as a very pure or very clean heart. Not even the Prophet Muhammad or any other messenger. How can we apply this rule? How can someone's heart, okay, be sound? There is no heart that is sound. We all are humans and we all sin and we all repent to Allah. You see how the man of religion used this carte blanche, this white card. If someone comes to you, we're going to take the example of I've forgotten the term. You have the policeman who is dressed in the uniform and the other policeman who comes to you in plainclothes officers. If they come and want to ask you a question, what is the first thing you tell them? Who are you? And they say, I'm a police officer. Do you have any ID? When you're asking for the badge. And that's why in movies from America and things like that, when they are FBI agents, they just dingle the badge in front of your face, and in which case you go, oh, you are the FBI, and then you cooperate or you don't cooperate, whichever way you want to go, right? This hadith is the badge that gives authority to the sheikhs to control the masses. That's the real purpose. So that later on when they go and project what Muawiyah wants or any other king after that or president in our times now, the sheikhs have the badge because they are the minority. That the hadith says, know the things that are ambiguous and unclear, and the majority needs the minority to figure out how to lead Islam. Because if the majority doesn't listen to the minority, they are just like the shepherd who takes his animals to eat, and they're going to end up in haram. And once you enter in those confusing things, your heart becomes corrupt, the body becomes corrupt, to hellfire you go. You better listen to the sheikhs. You see? So how did the sheikhs accomplish this power that they have over us? It really is simple. They divided the sources of legislation in Al-Islam to three sources. Yes, I say three. Usually they say four and they start with the Quran. But as we know it, they don't use the Quran. It's there just garnishing, like, yes, it's the Quran. Just not to exclude it. But in reality, the Quran has no weight whatsoever. Source number one, they say the Sunnah. And the Sunnah for them includes what the Prophet said, did, approved, or disapproved. Or so they say. And then point number two, the source number two of the legislation. So what they're saying is this. If we don't find the Quran, the legislation, we go to the Sunnah. If we don't find in the Sunnah, we go into the next source, the consensus. And what they mean by consensus is that all scholars agree upon one thing. Of course, this is impossible because back then they didn't have telephone, they didn't have websites, they didn't have the internet. How do scholars in Egypt know what scholars in Iraq or in Morocco think? How can they claim consensus? And the point number three is the analogy. And they say, okay, if we have something that doesn't have a real state of affairs, and we see in the Quran something that is close to it, and we apply what's in the Quran to it. And I give an example. They say drugs. If you ask the sheikh about drugs or smoking cigarettes, and they go, oh, it's haram. And you go, why? They tell you because Allah has prohibited in the Quran wine. Why? Because wine intoxicates, and because wine, drugs also intoxicate, so they share the same ruling. That's it. You got it. So it's haram. So as you can see, the Quran is not part, but they count it. So for them, it's four, but for us, it's three. So we're going to go Quran number one. If they don't find it in the Quran, they go to the Hadith, the Sunnah. And the Sunnah is what the messenger said, did, and proved or disproved. Number three, the consensus is what the all scholars agreed upon. And if they don't find in the Quran, the Sunnah, the consensus, then they go to part number four, the analogy. Now, let me expose what this hadith narrative has truly given to the religious institutions. First, they say the Quran is a source, but in reality, we know the Quran ever gets invited to the legislation table. And if it does, it always is contended with a hadith with something else. So much so that even though Allah in the Quran, when speaking about dividing the inheritance, Allah always speak about a father should, if a father dies, the kids get this, this, this. Well, we have a hadith that says that prophets do not leave, we already seen it, that the prophets do not inherit, they do not leave inheritance. The only thing that they leave is knowledge. But the prophets are fathers. So when Allah says that the children should inherit from the parents, Allah did not exclude the prophets. So instead of throwing the idea that the prophets do not leave as inheritance wealth, what they did, they rejected what the Quran says and accepted that the prophets do not leave inheritance behind them. And this is a real disturbing case. But now you know. So the Quran, even though they mention it, but is never ever invited to the table unless it works for them. They bring an ayah that works for them. I come to the point number two, and here we're going to spend some time. It says, the Sunnah. As I have already mentioned, the Sunnah for them is anything that the Messenger of Allah did himself or said as an instruction, or he saw somebody doing something and he approved what he did, then it becomes a Sunnah. Or he saw somebody doing something and he disapproved, then it becomes a legislation. What they truly mean by this is, anything from the Sunnah is a source of legislation. Anything. It's either he did it, or said it, approved, or disapproved, is a source of legislation. Now, as I already have stated before, the general understanding of the Salafi cult, that the Sunnah rules and supersedes over anything else, even the Quran. And here is why they believe this. Why the Salafis believe that what the Messenger of Allah says, did, approves, disapproves, has more weight than what Allah says in Al-Quran. Brace yourselves, because you're going to hear something that is going to, if you are driving, stop, listen, because it's really mind-boggling. They say that And they say, and it actually is part of the Salafi cult, that as-sunnatu qadiyatun ala al-Qur'an wa laysa al-Qur'anu biqadin ala as-sunnah. They say, the translation of which is, the sunnah rules over the Qur'an, while the Qur'an does not rule over the sunnah. This one is mentioned by Yahya ibn Abi Kathir and Ad-Darimi. Ad-Darimi is a scholar of hadith. This hadith was reported by a man called Yahya ibn Salih. Yahya ibn Salih is a follower, is a tabi'i. A tabi'i, or when we say a follower, is the first generation that came after the companions, or what they call them, companions. We all know the hadith that says that the best of people, خير القرون قرني, or خير الناس قرني, the best of people are my generation. This is a hadith. And then after them comes the followers and the followers of the followers. Okay, so according to this narrative, the best of people are the companions, of course, who had civil war and killed themselves and murdered themselves, and they did what they did. They're the best of people. So actually, we Muslims today, we're not killing each other, so we're better than them by all stretch of anything. But anyhow, so the hadith states that the best of people are the companions, then the followers, then the followers. Of course, the hadith stops at the third generation, which means anyone after that is a loser. But alhamdulillah, we're not. But anyhow, so Yahya ibn Salih is the one who said that the sunnah rules over the Qur'an, i.e. the sunnah trumps the Qur'an. If we play in a card where, for example, the Joker trumps any other cards, if the player puts any card, no matter how high that card is, the moment you put the Joker wins. So what this man is saying is that the Sunnah trumps the Quran, i.e. if this Quran says go right, and the Sunnah go left, says go left, you go left. While the Quran does not rule over the Sunnah. Yeah, right. This Yahya ibn Salih, no one is sure when he died. We don't know when he died. There are two opinions. One of them says in 129 Hijri. The other one says 132. That's a difference of 3 years. But this man's reliability, this Yahya ibn Salih, his reliability in transmitting any narrative is not agreed upon. He is again disputed. Like Ismail ibn Abi Waiz, the one we mentioned a while ago. So this man is, his authenticity, his position in Islam is disputed. Some men of religion say he is reliable, while others, as in Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani said, I will mention now to Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, I will come back to him. He says, هو ثقة ثبت لكنه يدلس ويرسل. What Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani said, وثبتٌ, meaning he is resolute and faithful in his religion, he's strong in his religion. And because of these external attributes, the scholars of hadith consider this title of ثبتٌ a high level of authentication. This is Ibn Hajar who keeps saying this. And as such, they accept his narrations. Therefore, to them, this man, whatever he said like the Sunnah rules over the Qur'an, while the Qur'an does not rule over the Sunnah, has reached a high level of authentication. And all the narration of this man, Yahya ibn Salih, are to be accepted. Furthermore, he said, ثِقَةٌ. And the narrator who is ثِقَة, i.e. trustworthy, is he who is fair and just. But the thing is, the hadith, in the hadith community, they define him as the trustworthiness. Let's go a little bit further, because it will ache. So until now, this Yahya ibn Salih is good. Ready? The man who gave authority to a hadith over the Quran is good, is a great man. But now let's go to the other side of what Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani said. For your information, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani is a scholar of hadith that does not subscribe to the Salafi creed. He's Ash'ari. And the Salafis, they hate the Ash'aris. It's an ongoing battle. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani is an Ash'ari. But why did the Salafis accept him? Why do they respect him? Why do they call him Amirul Mu'mineen of the hadith? The commander, the leader of the commanders of the hadith, just like Amirul Mu'mineen in real life is the president, is like Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani is the president of the people of the hadith. Why? They hate Ash'aris. They actually call them kafir. I personally heard one fatwa of a Salafi sheikh. They told him, "Ya sheikh, if someone is Ash'ari, they say, oh, he's misguided." Then he was asked, why is it then that Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani and Nawawi, who explained Muslim, and few other sheikhs that are Ash'ari, are they also misguided? You know what the answer was? He told them, no, the people who died, we cannot refer to them as misguided. We only talk about the live ones. Go figure this one out. So why Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, who follows the Ash'ari creed, is so much thought of, so much praised, so much over-amplified and exaggerated in the Salafi sphere? Why? Well, it's simple, really. Once you know why, then you understand. Because when Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani came in his era, and he was about 600 years ago, it's not far from us, when he wanted to explain, to explain the meanings of the hadith of al-Bukhari, he found that there were 13 versions of the book, 13 versions of al-Bukhari. And there were incessant battles between the different denominations. This group says, oh, this hadith is sahih, and al-Bukhari, the other one says, no, it doesn't exist in my Bukhari book. And it doesn't, and you can see how it gets. 13 versions. So what did Ibn Hajar do? He went and reconciled between these 13 versions. He combined them. He went and he takes this hadith and he goes, oh, in this book it's not mentioned, in that book it's mentioned, but the chain of narrator is different, and the real author of al-Bukhari that we have today is Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, who combined it from 13 other versions of al-Bukhari. This is why the Salafis respect him and put him high and never ever mention his Ash'ari creed. They never mention that. They just tell you Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani and that's it, and he's highly respected. That's the real... how much they lie to us. Now, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani carries on. This man who is honest, who is of high level of authentication, who is trustworthy, who is fair and just, has a small tiny problem. That tiny problem is at-tadlis. He does at-tadlis and irsal. At-tadlis, my dear sisters and my brothers, is when a person claims to have directly heard or learned from their teacher. But when in fact they haven't heard it directly from their teacher, they heard it from a third source, another source, but when they speak, they make people believe that they heard it directly from their sheikh. In other words, when the person who is described as a person of honor, like this man here, Yahya ibn Salih, when he is described as a good person, he is in fact, he lied about his source of knowledge. He learned it from somebody else, but said it was from his teacher. He lied about the knowledge itself, because he has no guarantee that what he heard was exactly what his sheikh said. And by him saying that, oh, this, I heard it from the sheikh, people would think that what he heard, what he's saying is exactly what the sheikh said. I could, for example, hear his student, I hear the teacher say, tomorrow it's going to be hot, just an example. And then I go and say, oh, the teacher said tomorrow is going to be snowy. He heard that what I said is that tomorrow it's going to be snowy, right? And then what Mr. Yahya ibn Salah goes and says, tomorrow, oh, it's going to be snowy. But hey, how did you hear that? Oh, my sheikh said. But in fact, the sheikh said tomorrow it's going to be nice and sunny, things like that. Just to give you an example. So he lied even about the knowledge he had, and he used the name of his respectable sheikh to pass whatever he wanted people to believe. He tricked people into taking him for what he is not. How can such a person be related to as a trustworthy, as an honorable, as a fair and just, as a person that we should take our Islam? Worse, how can we listen to him when he says that the Sunnah can rule over the Quran while the Quran cannot rule over the Sunnah? How can that be? So this is for at-tadlis. But when it comes to the irsal, al-irsal is another ball game altogether. Al-Irsal is when they mention, when he mentions a hadith, he jumps the one who told him the hadith and straight away links it to the messenger. Straight away links it to the messenger. What does that mean? It really is simple. It means that if to the scholars, if he said, oh, the messenger of Allah said, and they know that this man has not met with the messenger, hey, they know he's just, he omitted whoever reported it. But to the general public, to the public who have no knowledge, the people who go about their lives, when they hear this Yahya ibn Salih tell them that the messenger of Allah said, and he makes them believe that he heard it from the messenger, they will not say, oh, he heard it from somebody else. It was not direct from the messenger of Allah. So he was giving them false information. How come this man, Yahya ibn Salih, who never saw the messenger, already, who is considered by others as a fraudulent, deceptive liar, how can we accept his statement that the Sunnah rules over the Quran while the Quran does not rule over the Sunnah? How? How? The man Yahya ibn Salih, who never saw the messenger, never saw him, is a fraudulent, deceptive liar, says that the Sunnah rules over the Quran while the Quran does not rule over the Sunnah. And we are supposed to accept this idiocy, this insanity. When you go to Islam QA and the Salafi Sheikh is asked about this, he answers, Yahya ibn Salih said, and he doesn't tell you who this man is, but you don't search and you don't research, and you will think, oh, Yahya, if this great Sheikh mentions that Yahya ibn Salih must be a big shot Sheikh, and as such, if this Sheikh accepts what Yahya ibn Salih said, it must be great. When in fact, it is not great at all. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, this Egyptian hadith scholar born 1370, like about 8 centuries ago, drove us against a deep wall. And this is why they call him the Amir al-Mu'min, the ultimate leader of the believers in hadith, when in fact he's the true, and that title, he earned it just because he has authored al-Bukhari. I'll stop here because we've reached the 50 mark, and I'll carry on inshallah in part 4. This is again about the halal and the haram.